So good afternoon. My name is Shashi Prakash. I will be your facilitator for Lean Six Sigma Black Belt training program. In the meantime, let me just give a very brief introduction about myself. My name is Shashi Prakash. I'm a certified Lean Six Sigma Master Black Belt. And I have roughly 22 years of experience. And until 2014, I was engaged with the corporate sector, primarily the service sector. I've never been a part of manufacturing sector myself. Till I was engaged with corporate sector, more with the BPOs and IT enabled services. Work for clients like American Express, US, and American Express Australia. Dealt with the quality, compliance, legal stuff. That's been, so I was into operations, quality, all throughout practically. Since 2014, if I talk about the journey, when I actually got into free, like full-time consulting in Lean Six Sigma sphere. So it's been a roller coaster. It's Lean Six Sigma is something which gives you the possibilities to work in every possible sphere, every possible domain. There's no limitation to it. So coming from a service industry background, I've been working for oil and natural gas, constructions, healthcare, hospitality, data centers, and practically whatnot. So I'm a registered project management practitioner. So with the PMP knowledge that I've gained, I use it for my Six Sigma projects and the training part. So technically, this is the area, one area where I specialize in. I prefer to be master of one rather jack of all trades. So don't get into anything else. So basically, during this journey, we'll try to kind of give you a quick background about this particular training program and talk about black belt, which is for the corporates. It's very different from what you see in the regular world. And when we talk about, there are a lot of training programs which you generally see. Corporate black belt training programs are more customized from a project implementation standpoint. So you will be more engaged in doing something rather than a slide or theory when I'm teaching some stuff, and it's going to be more of an activity based, because in real world scenario, you will have a problem to solve. And the objective is to make sure that, yes, we are able to get that required knowledge so we can execute a project right after this training. For that matter, we can use our own organization data and start looking for some sort of solution with that data. So whatever tools we discuss, we'll actually be working on it. So we develop understanding of every tool. So the knowledge is not restricted in terms of theory. It's more of an experiential learning. So there'll be no burden for you to memorize things, because the best form of learning is practical learning. When you do it, well, you don't have to memorize nothing, no burden. So with black belt content being massive, it's very, very difficult to kind of memorize stuff. So best way to do is execute it, do it yourself, and that's the best way. And that will be then pretty much you don't need anyone to guide you how to do a project. So keeping that in mind, the entire content has been customized, and let me quickly share my screen with this syllabus. Now this is more about, we have initial part. I'm sure because you all have gone through some sort of formal training on yellow belt and green belt, we already understand the terminologies, most of the terminologies, but still as a curriculum, it's a part of it. So we'll try and kind of go through today's very, very light day. We will try to kind of understand the concepts, the evolution of it. And I'm sure in case at some point in time, we're going for some sort of certification, then it's important to, in project, when you're doing a project in your organization, these things may not matter because this is history. What is definition? Nobody's going to ask you a definition there. But if you're going to apply for, obviously, certification, then we should know all these things, because as black belt, you'll be expected to know in and out. As green belt, at least you have somebody to look up to. I don't know, black belt is there. But as a black belt, you're the supreme authority there. You have to have answer to every possible question. Black belt should not have a limitation. So we will start up, this is more of a initial part of it. A lot of history, a lot of jargons, and unfortunately, it's a part of most of the examination. So we will go through it. That's what is the process, but it will help you understand and develop the concepts right. Then we actually start with the actual project-based model. So how you actually start a project. So it is very different from what you will see in a book. This is how a project needs to be picked up. So you collect the voice of customer, VOC is voice of customer. So we'll discuss about different methods, how voice of customer needs to be collected, project collection, project initiation ideas. What are the different ways we can explore those ideas? When you collect those ideas, how will you classify them? Again, that's a project management PMP tool. We use an affinity diagram. When you selected multiple problems as an organization, how do you go about selecting a project? Well, at one point in time, I might have 20 different problems. I can't solve every problem with one project. So selecting a project is again a critical element. So how do you select and prioritize a project? So there are different options. We will discuss about different options which are available to select a project. Then develop a tree diagram to decide the final project metric which we'll be working on. Greenbelt, we must have, I'm sure, gone through the project charter part of it. We will write a project charter. So the intention is not to show you a project charter. Well, we should know how to write a project charter. The most critical element in your defined phase is your project charter. So we must, it's not good enough to write good project charter. We have to be excellent in writing it. So we'll try to go and do a deep dive into this part. Now some bit of portion, which is more from a examination standpoint in real world scenario, stages of team development, how when you have a team, you all have teams. So generally a project team evolves through different stages. So we'll talk about that. While we work on this team part of it, we've got to be working with communication plan, again, picked up from your PMP, RACI or RASIC. Six Sigma people have converted RACI into a RASIC version. So we'll discuss both of them. Then there's a quality function deployment for projects when we are doing a research and development. We will talk about that. That's a more extensive tool. Now we'll do a deep dive into 7 management and planning tools, generally referred as 7 MP tools. Extensive, very, very extensive. If you've gone through PMP, pretty much we have, we will have to understand, because defined phase is all about project management. So Six Sigma is a mix of every possible thing. So yes, it's all defined phase is completely about your PMP related material. So we will do a deep dive into all this. So we'll design and develop, understand how do you estimate the timeline of a project, how long it will take, 3 months, 6 months, how the timelines are estimated. So we'll discuss about CPM and PERT chart and various others management tools which we have there. Then stepping into the measure phase. Now, when you talk about measure phase, this is how, like basically, these are the activities that you need to perform to complete your defined phase. So actually a real world project will flow through these modules. And then you have your measure phase. So just quickly going through this, some bit of statistics, which we definitely need to understand. So we'll cover that up. We'll do these activities, we'll solve some questions. And then actually the deliverables of measure phase will start. How do you start with the measure phase? What all activities that you perform? I'm sure you must be doing a lot of these things, but yes, it's now formally we kind of putting them together in a sequence. So when you approval for the project, how do you start after that? So what all do you do? Your sample size calculation, the data collection plan, measurement system analysis, all these things will have. So again, Sigma level calculations, different ways of dealing with it. This black belt is extensive, because green belt, we only deal with normal data. So if you can recall the normal, non-normal stuff. So green belt is only lined with normal data. Black belt is dealing with every possible data. So we'll deal with that, all possible ways to deal and explore analysis. Then comes your analyze phase, when you talk about very, very basic generic tools. Well, I'll say generic because we're talking about 7 quality tools, very basic. When you want to take it to an extensive, like an advanced level, then we talk about the hypothesis testing. And again, as I said, Greenbelt only deal with the normal data. So Greenbelt only will be dealing with these tests. That's it. These tests. That's it. Black belt will be dealing with, and this is a massive list of tests we will. So as black belt, there is no data in the world that you can't analyze. So we will sort of go ahead and deal and do a deep dive into it. Coming to your improve phase, how do you design and develop a solution? You go about testing the validation before and after analysis. It's a complete comprehensive how a project needs to be done, control charts, doing all those calculations. That's the roadmap. We will talk about lean in the end. It's not a broad topic, but still lean implementation principles, various methods of calculation in lean. And finally, the complicated part, being very honest, well, that's what we deal with, design of experiment. So which is the most advanced method of everything. So we parked it for the end, because for you to understand design of experiment, we must have clarity about everything from defined till control. Everything is required, because everything gets merged together in design of experiment. So that's the curriculum that we'll be dealing with. People who have gone through this, I'm just going to show you a sample project so that we have a fair bit of idea how technically a project looks like, where people have like going through this module. Exactly, well, let me quickly show it to you. So by the way, I would like to kind of talk about, at least we, while we have been dealing with this is a sample, just a, this is not a real one, but a sample project. So we will be working with different, so this is the level of understanding I would expect, and we will definitely have how to start a project with the data. We will work with data. We will see how a project needs to move on, different kind of project management tools, and how do you do your analysis. So a lot of stuff which we saw in that course curriculum, we'll start doing it. So this is done by the people who have gone through the training. They have taken their time to work on the data, and they have started doing analysis. So when you have developed this level of understanding, then practically there's no looking back. You have no, you know, if I'm given a data, I can analyze the data in every possible way, and I can complete it. I can perform my statistical testing. I will know my answers. So that's what, and there are a lot of such sample projects which we have. So I'll be dealing with the data. I'll be sharing the data. There's a lot of material which will be going your way. So as of now, the courseware that we have, which is there. So all this is Minitab related output, because Black Belt can't be done without a Black Belt. So, but Black Minitab part will come in quite late, because initially we have to deal with your the project management part, which will take some time. So please wait while you're kind of trying to install Minitab, but because we need it later, it's not in the beginning. So once we complete your the initial part and define phase, after that we will need the Minitab part. So we can still hold on. I'll definitely let you know in advance that we need to start with the Minitab training, so you can install it in advance. So for now, we can hold on to that. Yeah, I was sort of giving you a quick introduction about myself. So I've been dealing with this exactly the same courseware, same training material. I've delivered this training, and I've been associated with almost most of the IITs in India. So the same training has been conducted in IITs, and I've delivered this training in most of the IIMs in India, with various business schools in India. Majority of my time, my secondary base is Qatar. Qatar is where I spent, like this Qatar World Cups are going on. I have been training most of the government officials in various departments of in Qatar, the transport, healthcare, energy, IT, all that part for Qatar. Because this, since last 3 years, this planning for the upcoming World Cup was going on. So every possible department has been trained. So we, for the last 3 years, I've been engaged and with the so all the Qatar University training for the last 3 years, I've delivered those trainings. So I've been associated with these industry, these institutions for training purposes. If I talk about most of my projects, well, that's again in the Middle East. That's where I'm more active, and some in Europe, some in India, some in Bangladesh. So that's been my area of, but if I talk about the kind of industries, well, it spreads across every possible domain. There's no restriction that we have in Lean Six Sigma world. So that's what it does to us. So given that courseware that we are dealing with, given the course that we're dealing with, some of the content is hardcore manufacturing. And I'm sorry to say that, but that's what it is. So we can't deal with it, because Six Sigma happens to be applied both in service industry, in manufacturing industry, in every possible industry. So some content are purely related with manufacturing. And since we got to be ready for the examination at some point in time, so all those content needs to be understood. So there will be some portion which, unfortunately, we like it or not, but it's part of the syllabus. We have to deal with that. So is it okay, clear, basically the understanding part? Is that fine with everyone?
Yes.
Perfect. Now, I will be preparing lots of notes. Actually, I prepared detailed notes. This is the Google Drive where I will be sharing these notes with everyone. Day-wise, this courseware that looking at. So this courseware, exactly these files, that's the courseware like broken by different phases. The same courseware is shared here. So with that being said, we're good to get started now. only thing what I'm expecting is your engagement, your involvement. Please do ask questions. I will definitely be doing that. But if you have any point which is not clear, if you want me to reduce the pace, if in case my pace, my tone is like it's quite fast, let me know. I will correct it. And if in case you think that the content is going too fast, let me know. So we are not in a hurry. We would still be able to work it easily. So if there is any feedback that you want to give it to me, please give it to me. Feedbacks are very important. And that's what, because the session is meant for you, it must make sense to you. So please do let me know as and when there is anything. I'll keep checking with you all any which is, but on that note, we are good to get started now. So first thing first, we will start with the basic introduction. Today's topics are very, very basics, but still, let's go and quickly talk about it. The first portion that we will be dealing with is about definition of quality. Well, what do you define? Like when you, somebody says like, well, define quality for me.
Meeting the specifications.
Perfect. That's spot on. Meeting the specifications. You are right. And so anyone else, like if you have any other perspective or definition of quality?
Quality actually consists in three values, like meeting the specification, on-time delivery, and error-free.
Okay. Error-free. Okay. Error-free. So we are dealing with the technically when we talk about internal. So like I said, there's nothing called a perfect definition, but all in all. When we say when we have a product or a service that is as an output, that output is neither good or bad unless and until a client defines the standard for us. For some client, 90% quality would be a great quality. For some, 95% could be a bad quality. So as the first definition is meeting specification, because till the time I don't have the specification, it's just an output. The output is neither good or bad. The quality definition will only come when there is a specification. Then with given that specification, I will say, is this product meeting that specification? If it's meeting, then it's good. If it's not, then it's bad. So quality will only come into play when there is a specification applicable. Otherwise, it's just an output. Whether it's a product or a service, it can't be called as good or bad. Good or bad only comes when you have a customer client target. Then we say, so it's technically meeting expectation. Specification. And with that being said, yes, it's all about consistency. Well, we got to ensure that we consistently meet those specifications. One of those specifications could be the on-time delivery. If we have been given a certain timeline target to deliver the project on time, it's pretty much it has to be within that. If we exceed the time, we are violating those specifications. So again, it's related to specification. And obviously, customer, the product has to be or service has to be error-free. So all in all, we all have a basic understanding, and this is nothing different. But to start with, when initial days, when this quality sort of thing, the definition evolved, it was a very tricky subject, because every time the manufacturer or service providers, when they used to manufacture or like deliver services, a different customer will come and give a different specification, and people used to criticize, well, I don't understand what is the right definition of quality. So it was very, very vague, because say in a simple layman version, if I go to a coffee shop and I ask for a good coffee, for my, as per my definition, a good coffee is, which is dark coffee, which is less sugar and probably no milk. That's the definition of good coffee for me. Another customer comes in and this customer wants extra milk and extra sugar. The definition of quality changed. So it's very important to, it was very, very difficult for people to define the standards of quality, because customers will keep on change the definition. So it was a very tricky subject to start with. So so there were people who sort of got into this definition of quality arena. So Deming is, he came with the same logic that we all are now talk about. This is that it is defined from the customer standpoint. That's what you all said. It's always defined from customer standpoint. If you meet those, then customer is happy. So that's what we are, even whatever Deming said, we are also saying the same thing. Juran is referred as father of quality. Well, so technically, this gentleman came up with a definition, which is fitness for use. Now, I'll sort of give you a quick update about like Juran also, because he came with this definition, which says, so as per Juran, he said, that your product or service, your product or service can be called quality product or service if it fulfills two requirements. Number one, it must serve the purpose for which it was created. Second, you must give the customer that he or she values it. So this was the definition, which is generally asked in the examination. They kind of tweak things around and talk about who introduced this concept. Generally, there could be a scenario where they could ask you this, and because it's been seen very commonly, they ask, put this thing. So I wanted to kind of talk about this quickly. First, it's again fitness for use. It must serve the purpose for it was created. Fitness for use is what we're talking about. That's what his core mantra says, that if you have designed and developed a product, the customers will be unrealistic. You may get the finest product, you may get the best of the services delivered to the customer. Customer will still have another expectation. You fulfill another expectation, they will be happy. Will say that if we could add this, it'll be great. So the expectations of the customers will never end. Well, you buy a ceiling fan and you expect the ceiling fan to give me the comfort of air condition. Well, you've been unrealistic. So till the time the ceiling fan is doing the job of a ceiling fan, it's good. So fitness for use, well, whatever product you've designed, whatever services you've delivered, if it's doing that intended purpose, well, then it's good. Your customers will never end expecting more and more. So it must serve the purpose for which it was created. It's doing its basic job, it's good. It's good quality. It's meeting expectations, it's good. Bottom line. It further added one more important element, that you should not try to overdo something. Because when you overdo something, at times, customers will start doubting the quality of that product or service. You should only give that much. When you see those advertisements that buy two and get five free, well, the first thing comes to mind that these guys are cheating. Well, the first thing comes to mind, it's a cheap quality product. That's what it looks like. When you buy two and get five free, it's too much. It always creates a doubt in the mind about the quality. It's not a good quality product. Or these guys have already inflated the price and now they're giving 2 + 5, a sort of thing. So it's always a general like a concern in the mind of the customers. So we, Juran, kind of came up with this logic that don't try to, well, obviously we want to do the gold plating, always want to excite the customer, delight the customer. But try to understand there is a thin line when you end up overdoing it. So we got to keep on evaluating I hope we are not overdoing it. Because when you overdo, you might, your quality might be perceived as a bad quality or cheap quality. Like if I go to by God's grace, say, I hope this COVID situation goes away. And say we're planning to spend a good time with our family and friends in a fine dining restaurant. Now, I go to a fine dining restaurant, this person gets us seated in a properly and takes the order from us. But within 5 minutes, this guy gets the food. Well, it's a fine dining restaurant. Probably he got all the staff to get the work done so I can be served as soon as possible. Well, first of all, that's where it brings a big question mark. Too soon, too early. Because I understand it's a fine dining restaurant. I will have to wait. Everything will be prepared fresh. But when you got all your resources to get the work done too soon, too early, even that will bring question. Well, probably somebody offered, somebody ordered, and somebody did not pick it up. And I am being given the leftover of somebody. Somebody canceled the order. It's not fresh. Because it's too soon, too early, it's not possible. Well, I am trying to have my food and with my friends and family having a conversation. This guy is standing right on my head. Why? Because he wants to be available. If I need something, I don't have to look for somebody. He's just there for me, but I don't like it too much because you're listening to my conversation. You're invading my privacy. So we got to ensure that, yes, when we try to give quality, we should not overdo it because it will hurt the definition of quality for us. So Juran came up with a revival because people were trying at this time frame, people were trying to kind of go and overdue to get more and more market share. And that was hurting the brand image. So Juran sort of helped people to kind of come up with that basic definition. ASQ, when we talk about, they give basic same, like it, or we can use it differently, but it all seems to say, it says the same thing. Total, the totality of the feature and characteristics of the product or services, its ability to satisfy the stated or implied needs. Bottom line, we're talking about the same thing, customer specification. If your product or service is able to meet those expectations of the customer, it's good. So your answers were 100% correct when you said meeting expectation, consistent, delivery, error-free, that's what is quality. There's now no other different definition for quality. People have been, different people have come up and given definition differently. But what definitely to keep in mind from examination standpoint, this is the most common one. So yes, I'll keep on sharing things which are very important from examination standpoint, wherever it comes in, those pointers, because it will be a very detailed note, a lot of content. So to understand, you quickly want to glance certain areas, pretty much you can always look at those pointers. So that's about the quality part.